It's a 138th Friday group meeting. The speaker is Mr. Subodh Markandeya, Senior Advocate. The topic is Citizenship Amendment Act 2019. Some pertinent questions. Regarding sir, even earlier also, I mean, he addressed our Friday group. On 29 January 2016, the challenges of the Supreme Court practice. Part 2, same challenges of the Supreme Court practice is the earliest. That time we don't have a recording. And so, 1st, 2nd, 2019, Bhulabhai, Indian legal legacy, Bhulabhai Deshai, and the prominent legal personalities in Indian freedom movement. And 39, 2019, Apex Court's litigant quest for justice. And meanwhile, 12 January 2018, Hindu Succession Act, somehow that was deleted, I mean, it could not upload it, remaining all. And when we celebrated 100th Friday grouping, so was scrutinized the entire, I mean, Friday group book and other thing. Sir immediately agreed. We are very grateful to sir. You are all the way, you came all the way. Sir, before that we will introduce one by one. I mean, so before this, sir, I am G.Seshagiri.
Good evening, everyone. It's a very controversial subject on which I have to speak. So one third I will devote to the constitutional provisions in regard to the citizenship. One third I'll devote to the demography. India lives in very dangerous neighborhoods and we haven't learned to separate the immigration part and the citizenship part. The what I may call the prosperous countries guard their citizenship very, very jealously. And of course, they allow others to come, immigrate, work there and go away. But somehow we have this porous borders, porous laws, all these have created problems for us. Therefore, since I did some research about the demography part, I do want to speak a bit on this. At least one fourth part. Of course, probably it's a little controversial, but it's inevitable. Then one, the last part. So now let's start. Citizenship Act is the fastest enacted law by Parliament of India. It was passed in the Lok Sabha on 10th of December 2019, in Rajya Sabha next day. Received the assent of the President on the next day, and of course on 12th of December 2019 it came into force. As lawyers, we are concerned only with the constitutional and legal aspects. But of course the demography is very inevitable part of what has been enacted now. So some time will have to be devoted. And a very large number of matters are pending before the Supreme Court. Being a very old-fashioned man, I don't want to make any comment which may be construed as contempt of court. No doubt, this act will receive the consideration of the Supreme Court in all its variegated dimensions, and any comment by me will not be appropriate. So I will refrain from doing any comment. Let's start by having a bird's eye view of the provisions of Part 2 of the Constitution, which deals with the citizenship. Articles 5 to 11, they deal with citizenship. And when read with entry 17 of List 1 of the 7th Schedule, the matter is totally within the exclusive domain of the Union of India, which is beyond doubt. But things keep on, people keep on saying, people who are not concerned with either the enactment of citizenship, any law on citizenship, or who have to kind of deal with this. So that's why I want to emphasize that this subject matter of citizenship is within the exclusive domain of Union of India. And all the assembly resolutions and all just irrelevant. Now, Articles 5 to 9 deal with historical aspects of citizenship. I call it historical because they deal with the citizenship at the commencement of the Constitution. Probably we are not really concerned with these provisions directly, but they do, they are a very important part of the interpretation of whatever citizenship law is enacted later by Parliament. So I'll deal briefly with this. Kindly see. Article 5 makes three kinds of people citizens of India at the inception. Those who were born in the territory of India, those one of whose parents was born in India, and those who were ordinarily residents in India for not less than 5 years. Then Article 6 confers citizenship on migrants to India whose parents or one of the grandparents were born in the undivided India, that is in India as per Government of India Act of 1935. If he migrates before 1948 and has been ordinarily resident therein since migration. Article 7 makes an exception to those referred to in Articles 5 and 6 against those who migrated from Pakistan after 1947. Proviso to that article carves out an exception in favor of those who migrated to Pakistan but returned under a permit for resettlement or permanent return issued by the appropriate authority, and such persons are deemed to have migrated into India after 1947-1948. So just see, we were very broad-hearted. Those who went and came back under permit were also allowed to be citizens of India. Then Article 8 is very important because it protects the citizenship of those persons who either or whose parents or grandparents were born in undivided India, but he is resident outside India. Article 9 excludes from the benefit of Indian citizenship those who voluntarily acquire foreign citizenship. This is logical because if you acquire voluntarily the citizenship of another country, then naturally you will, because we don't have the system of dual citizenship in our country. Article 10 is very important because it guarantees the continuance of Indian citizenship to persons mentioned in Articles 5 to 9 subject to any laws made by Parliament. These provisions are now, you know, of historical value because we are all, I think I was born prior to the Constitution, but most of us are now. Now, Article 11 deals with the power of Parliament to enact laws relating to acquisition and termination of citizenship and all the matters connected to citizenship. Now, in exercise of power under Article 11, read with Entry 17 and of List 1 of the 7th Schedule, Parliament has enacted the Citizenship Act 1955, which has been amended from time to time. So the scheme of the Citizenship Act is that citizenship can be acquired under Section 3 by birth, under Section 4 by descent, under Section 5 by registration, and under Section 6 by naturalization, and under Section 7 when territory is incorporated into India, like we liberated Goa, so the French possessions were handed over to India, so Article 7 applies. Then Sikkim was incorporated into India, so Section 7 applies. Now, There is a special provision, section 6A, which relates to the persons covered by Assam Accord, with which at the present time we are not concerned. Section 7A to 7B relate to overseas citizenship of India cardholder, its conferment, cancellation, etc., which is also part of the present amended act, but I will not deal with that. It's one of the parts of this amending act of Citizenship Amendment Act. Now the question for this evening's address is, why was the Amendment Act was passed? So this part I have to read because I did some research on this, and although it is little, it can make us little uncomfortable, but still. The prosecution of six communities from three countries, six communities, that is to say Buddhist, Christians, Hindus, Jains, Sikhs, and
Parsis.
Yes.
So,
yes.
Yeah. So at this has some problem, this has some connection with the demographic data, and the seeds of persecution are also embedded in the constitution and laws of these three countries, that is to say Afghanistan, Pakistan and Bangladesh. Now some of the research which I made shows some very disturbing phenomena. One gentleman called Kishan Gopal, he has written an article on the demography of Punjab in 2004, Journal of Punjab Studies, volume 14, number 1, pages 3 to 9, in which he has said that according to the census of India of 1941, the population of undivided Punjab comprised of, now whatever is the majority in that province of Punjab, they were 53.25, Hindus were 29.1%, Sikhs were 14.9%, and Christians were 1.9%. Now in the province of Punjab in Pakistan, the population of these communities have diminished to less than 1%. There is another study by Nandita Bhavnani in the Journal of South Asian Studies. It's published in 2016, volume 36, number 1, pages 790 to 804, according to which the non-Muslim population of Sindh in the census of 1941 was 27%, and now it has diminished to 3%. So there is a loss of 24% in Sindh, there is a loss of a very considerable loss in what is now Punjab province of Pakistan. Now at that time, present-day Bangladesh was East Pakistan. So a very large study which has been funded and executed by 10 very prestigious American universities under the leadership of one gentleman called Hill, he has made a work called Demographic Impact of Partition on Bengal, 2005. This is available on the website of Princeton University, princeton.edu. So according to that, the population of undivided Bengal was 55% Muslims, 42% Hindus and 3% tribals, which has now diminished to 20, 2.5% in 1951, and according to 2011 Bangladesh census, the population of Hindus and tribals is 9.6%. So this is the loss. This is the raison d'etre for enacting the present act. Now, the first exodus of first wave of distress, exodus of minorities into India took place in 1947, and it has remained unabated. In 1964, one particular community called Chakmas, who were Buddhist, were wholesale evicted from Chittagong Hill Track area of the then East Pakistan. The second distress exodus, which was largest in the world, took place in 1971, prior to the Bangladesh War, when 10 million people, 1 crore people, took refuge in India. They were all Hindus or Muslims, everyone was there. That was because of the unprecedented atrocities committed by the Pakistani army in Bangladesh. And it's a fully documented exodus. And these have all been catalogued. I have studied 3. So Mr. Kasturi Rangan is one of them. Marjolina Zilek is one. And Elvin Toffler in 1997. They have reported that out of 10 million refugees, only 6.8 million returned to Bangladesh. 3.2, that is 32 lakhs are... So this is the reason why this had been enacted. Now there is something I want to say, but I would still refrain from saying that the constitution and laws of these 3 countries are very harsh to minorities. Various American studies have pointed out the harshness, and some official agencies have also pointed out to the harshness. I had studied, but I will refrain from saying, particularly, of course, Afghanistan is one country from which is also included in this, but there what has happened that the total population of minorities, these 6 minorities, in 1964 was 3 lakhs. It has now reduced to 3,000. But the problem in Afghanistan is little different, because there more than half of the country is under the regime of Taliban, which do not believe either in human rights, or in fact, one of the reasons why no settlement is being arrived at is because of the constitution. If I study that constitution of Afghanistan, I am frightened at the harshness towards the minorities, towards women. But that's the issue with Taliban. They say this is too liberal. This is the... Of course, Pakistan researchers said it's the better. I have studied whole 2 pages, but I'll refrain from it. It's extremely harsh. Now, what does the Amendment Act do? What does the Amendment Act do? The Amendment Act inserts in the Principal Act the following things. Proviso to subsection, this is the most important part. Proviso to section 2, subsection 1, clause B. This is the most important part, because this defines what is called illegal migrant. An illegal migrant is not entitled to the consideration of his application for citizenship. That is why a proviso has been added in section 21B. Then it adds section 6. I'll come each purpose of each of these sections. But at this juncture, we'll just note that section 6B has been added after section 6A. Clause DA has been added after clause D in section 7D. Proviso to clause F has been added to section 7D. Clause EEI has been added to section 18.2, and proviso has been added to clause D of third schedule to the Citizenship Act. So now let's see what each one of them does. Clause B of subsection 1 of section 2 of the Principal Act defines illegal migrant. That is a migrant who has entered India without any legal document. So we are now essentially concerned with these persons. A person who has entered India without legal document, or who has entered India with a valid legal document but has stayed beyond the permitted time. Now, by adding this proviso B to subsection 1 of section 2 of the Citizenship Act, what relaxation has been given is this section 2.1 is a very harsh provision, because it disables an illegal migrant even to apply for the citizenship. So what it does is it relaxes. Proviso relaxes the rigor of the harsh provisions in favor of the persons of six religious communities, namely Buddhists, Christians, Hindus, Parsis, Jains, and Sikhs, who were originally residents of Afghanistan, Bangladesh, and Pakistan, have now migrated to, have entered India. That also before a particular date, namely 31st December 2014. And who have been exempted from, by the central government, by, or to be, that's of course in future, who will be exempted by the central government by or under section 3.2b of the Passport Entry into India Act, or from the application of the Foreigners Act. Now section 3 adds section 6b after section 6a. Now, subsection 1 of this section B enables the central government or a specified authority to grant a certificate of registration or a certificate of naturalization to a person covered by the newly added proviso to section 2.1b. And it's not that he makes an application and gets the citizenship. No, not like that. He has to make an application and fulfill the prescribed conditions, restrictions, and of course the manner of applying section 3.2. And subject to the fulfillment of the conditions specified in section 5 for qualification for naturalization laid down in third schedule. He has to prove that he is no doubt illegal immigrant, but he is persecuted minority from one of these three countries. It's not as if he walks in and makes an application. He has to satisfy the central government or the authority concerned that he is a persecuted minority, one of the six persecuted minorities coming from these three countries. Now, once this certificate is given, he will be deemed to be a citizen of India from the date of his entry into India. Subsection 3 is a consequential provision. It says that any proceeding, naturally proceedings would have been taken against him for illegal migration. So all those proceedings to such a grantee or will abate. So this is a provision for abatement of the proceedings against him. And he will not be disqualified on the ground of pendency of proceedings. So these are consequential provisions. Nor will his application for citizenship be rejected on that ground. If he is otherwise found qualified under section 6b, an applicant under section 6b will not be deprived of his rights and privileges to which he will be entitled to on the date of receipt of his application on the ground of his making an application for citizenship. So it's not as if, you know, he just walks in, makes an application, and he has to satisfy the authority. It's upon satisfaction that he will get the citizenship. So rigor is not so much relaxed. It's not given just for asking. He has still to satisfy that he is from one of those countries and he belongs to one of those communities. Now, Section 4 of Section 3 excludes, because there is some problem with Assam, Meghalaya, Mizoram, those are specially taken. So, Subsection 4 of Section 3 excludes the tribal area of Assam, Meghalaya, Mizoram, Tripura as per 6th schedule of the Constitution and areas covered by inner line notified by Bengal Eastern Frontier Regulation of 1873. So the amending act will not apply to these two types of areas, namely tribal areas of Assam, Meghalaya, Mizoram and Tripura and the inner line notified under that act, Bengal Act. Section 5 of this act inserts clause EEI in section 18. Because the central government did not have power to do all this, so they can make rules now relating to conditions, restrictions and the manner of granting registration and naturalization certificate under newly added section 6B. Section 6 of the amending act adds a proviso to clause D of third schedule of the act, the effect of which is to reduce the period of aggregate period required for residence in India or being in the service of Government of India from 11 years to 5 years. In other words, if you have emigrated into India 5 years back, you will be eligible. It only makes eligible. These are only provisions which make, otherwise law operates very harshly on them. Under the Passport Entry into India Act and the Foreigners Act, they will be detained, they will be harassed, they will be expelled also. So these are the... So ultimately, if we examine these sections, it will be clear that they have been enacted only to remove the disqualifications of an illegal immigrant into India who entered India before 31st December 2014 from three countries, namely Afghanistan, Bangladesh and Pakistan, and who belongs to one of the 6 religious communities who have been persecuted in those countries, namely Buddhists, Christians, Hindus, Jains, Parsis and Sikhs. So this is all about although I don't want to comment much, but still I cannot help saying that so far as Article 14 is concerned, to my mind, the classification is absolutely rational. It speaks of 6 communities, it speaks of 3 countries from whom these gentlemen have come, and all that the law does is to enable them to apply for the citizenship of this country. As we have seen, you know, in Pakistan, the demographic data shows that practically, I would say that they have wiped off the minorities from that country. Bangladesh situation has been not very good, because there have been exodus, 3 waves of exodus. First in 1947, which they remained unabated. Second was in 1971. And since I omitted to read that part, the third wave came when Bangladesh, which was a secular country, was converted by General Zia-ul-Rahman into an Islamic country. And it was followed by measures which diminished the population of it's a very friendly country. I would refrain from saying anything, but 2 spells of regime by him. He was assassinated ultimately, and two spells by his wife Khalida Zia were extremely uncomfortable for the minorities. This is it.
No, further you want to enlarge anything, you can enlarge, sir.
No, a very large, but I had studied the constitution of Pakistan, and it's very frightening, as I said, that many American studies have...
find out about Pakistan part, sir, even Indian part, I mean, a lot of unrest is going in this country. What are the issues, sir, for unrest?
No, the unrest is, I would comment only this much, that the speed with which the act was passed, probably the message has not percolated down, that, see, this is like, if I am injured, I am lying on the road, and ambulance picks me up, I am the person who is to be picked up. Others can't say, don't pick him up, we are also, but where are you? You are not injured. Injured one is to be picked up. The persecuted has to be ameliorated. Can any ameliorative measure ever be challenged? This is my question. It's an ameliorative measure. It doesn't affect anyone. But this message had to be percolated down to everyone. And the speed with which it has been enacted probably has not given us enough room to think, to ponder, and to come to the conclusion that it hurts no one.
Anyway, thank you very much, sir. So nice of you, given all constitutional provisions of the central government domain, not states. These are all clarified.